What do you think can happen now if those top profile athletes do choose a Jackson State? What do you think that would do not only for the program, but even the surrounding community here?
You know what? I guess the last maybe 2 or 3 weeks, I've been kind of talking to guys, former players who played at predominant Power Five conferences, the rising kids coming up, and the one thing that they talk about now is trying to do it, trying to come together, all of the older guys trying to, you know, push them that way or lean them that way. But then you get the younger guy, and the thing that he says, you know, why didn't you do it? And that's the big question that comes up. I think the thing for me, what I'm trying to sell them, if I don't think you can take one guy. I think it's going to have to be a collective effort of 3 or 4 guys, because that one guy, it's a load that he's going to have to carry. But the thing you get when you do 3 or 4 guys, let's say the preseason NIT tournament. You get invited to the preseason NIT tournament because you got 3 or 4 of the best players in the country. Now you're playing guarantee games where we play 13 guarantee games. Like we play 13 games, but maybe 11 of them guarantee games. Now you look just like they look when you go to the game, and you're going to win that game because you got the same kind of guy. So it's different. 30 for 30, a movie deal, you get everything. But it's that one time that you can do it, it'll change the whole landscape of college basketball. And that's what you try to sell them on, because it only take one time to do it, and it only take 3 or 4 guys. So it's easy, but it's not easy. But you got to convince, 3 or 4 sets of parents, 3 or 4 sets of AAU coaches, 3 or 4 sets of athletes. So it's a lot of moving pieces that got to come together in order for it to happen.
And Coach Reed, for you, we see it when it comes to those Power Five products. A lot of them, we've all seen it, just the transfer part of it. They may not start at HBCU, but eventually they get there. Of course, Misha Williams, she came in, she's winning awards after being at MSU for a year or two. So from your perspective, from the women's game, how are you seeing, I guess, recruits or even parents of recruits kind of hitting you up a little bit more and see we have some calls that you may not usually get, you're kind of getting them now. From your perspective, from the women's game, how do you think those top recruits choosing the Jackson State, especially going to a successful program like you've built here, what do you think that will do for the women's game?
Yeah, I think it's different dynamics from men's and women's basketball. The trend that's being set and the noise that's being made on the men's side is really awakening our female athletes as well. One thing that works in our favor is the fact that we have Power Five transfers here already with our Wichita State player and with our Mississippi State player as well. So players are able to see that. But one thing that we've been really selling and talking about is the fact that, let's face it, student athletes makes the university. Student athletes make the program. Student athletes really make the coaches, because it's not about the X's and O's, it's about the Jane and the Joes. And so it's really important for players to understand and see the big picture. And, you know, right now we have female athletes who have those big offers, but now they are talking to us as well. We've always been right there, you know, talking to them, but it's never been a really opening for it. You know, you have some different dynamics that people try to use against us, you know, in terms of stipends, in terms of, you know, facilities, in terms of travel. But players have to understand we can offer the same things. You just have to give us a chance. At our level, we have to be strategic with those things. And so before we can even put forth our strategy and let you know how we can give you those things, we have to get your ear first. And so I think now, well, where we are, I think players are more open to hearing it and more open to accepting it, and really rallying together to want to come be a change and be a difference. You know, one thing that we've been saying is be a trendsetter, you know, change the way this arena of basketball is viewed in terms of collegiate sports and colleges that recruits choose to go play for. Define history, you know, do something different. So that's, you know, that's kind of the selling point, and that's really getting a lot of players excited right now. We have to keep in mind that historically black colleges were the only universities who were educating African Americans. And so when everything became more diverse, you know, everything opened up, but the platform is here. The platform is here. And not only are, you know, my biggest thing is we can offer what you get anywhere else. Just have an ear to listen for it.
For sure. Coach Brent, when you look at, and it kind of dovetailing off of that, historically HBCUs, Jerry Rice played at Mississippi Valley State.
Right.
And Terrell Owens played at a small school as well. So when you see that, and when you're trying to go into a recruit's room, if a top 10 guy in the state or Alabama says, all right, coach, you can come visit. Now that you do have that opportunity, I guess, how do you sell the program? How do you sell the opportunity so they seriously consider, what Jackson State or any other team in the SWAC or the MEAC have to offer?
I think we got to take advantage of the opportunity right now while it's here. Like Coach said, just mentioned, it's unfortunate with the George Floyd incident that it took this to get kids that started looking at a HBCU. This is 30 years for me coaching. I've been talking to a kid for the last 30 years about doing it because it's something special. This is the first time in 30 years that the kid has begun to say, okay, let me open the door just a little for you to get in here. That's the first time that the parent has said, okay, you know what? We thinking about it. Not we gonna sign, we thinking about it. But just to get them to think about it is good. Once the NCAA gives us the clearance where we can bring kids in and we can have the official visits, I got three or four guys coming in that normally wouldn't come in. And we probably bring all three of them in at the same time because we're trying to paint a picture for them. It's different if all three of y'all decide to come. Like Coach just mentioned, I don't care what play you run. If you put three McDonald's All-Americans out there, all your plays work. And it's a lot different when you can throw that ball up and somebody can jump over top of somebody and go get it just because they got a superb athletic talent. That's a lot different. Yes, you have to be coached and you got to do all of this and that. But if I can come down and make plays and do this and that, it's a lot different coaching you than not being able to do it. But this is the first time, and like I said, in the last 20, 25 years that the talk has been there and you're getting the calls and I'm even getting calls from parents and kids calling me where we didn't get that. So now what we're trying to do now is figure out how do we tip it over? How do we get them to say, okay, I want to come? And I guess, from the last couple of talks that I'm getting with kids is just the group thing. Coach, if you can get somebody else to do it with me, it's something that all I'm talking about.
And Coach, for you, does it take just one? I mean, we saw the impact that Amisha had her first year. And even around a conference when transfers come in, from a coaching perspective, when you get one young lady that decides, you may not get maybe two or three in a class, like Coach Brent was talking about, but if you get one, say Amisha gets SWAT Player of the Year next year, you guys go to the NCAA tournament, she goes to the WNBA, do you think that will have a trickle-down effect? Or are you just looking like, if I can get one, mm-hmm. I can make it work, and hopefully it'll snowball from there?
Yeah, I think Amisha Williams is grabbing a lot of attention for us. And the fact that my phone is constantly ringing daily with agents trying to represent her and prepare her to enter the WNBA draft, I think it's a huge recruiting tool, and that's something that we definitely talk about. Because let's face it, your Power 5 athletes, they want to go to the next level. They want to be able to play professional basketball. And so I think that, with the platform that's already been laid, if we can just get one more. And normally, players have best friends who play, who are as good as they are. They play on AAU teams where teams are loaded with talent. And so if you can present a good package, a good marketing plan to that one to carry it to the next one, we may not be able to get two or three at that moment, but if we can just get that one, I think, with the impact that's already been made, one more continue to make it, and you continue to build. And I just think that on our side, if you can get two or three of those type of players on your team, you can go out and make some noise in preseason against those bigger schools. And once you start, building a team who can compete and who can win those type of games, that too will open up for you to be able to get more of those players. With the NCAA opening up to where players can benefit financially from their name, from their game, their marketing, that goes wherever you go. You know, if you wherever you choose to go, you're going to benefit financially from it. And so, you know, that's something that we're constantly selling to these top players. You know, wherever you go, they're going to follow you. You know, TV games, that opportunity is going to follow you. Finances is going to follow you. You just bring in a different crowd when you can be more diverse with your options and choosing where you want to go play. But definitely, I think one could start the domino effect for more to start coming.
And for both of you, what do you think the cultural impact it would have if we do see that year after year of, you know, players choosing HBCU schools? The fact that, you know, they could be in an arena where everyone more or less looks like them, is cheering for them. What do you think that could do, you know, culturally to see that, oh, our talent is, you know, quote unquote, staying with us. We can grow and develop talent just like the Power Five schools. What do you think the cultural impact that can have when these kids say, hey, I'm going to stay close to home, or I'm going to go here because I believe what they're doing and I like what I see? What do you think that can do culturally?
Well, I think it's huge. If Coach could remember when she played at Murrah High School, if you take it back to the high school level, you take a Murrah Provine game, and you know you got two black schools that probably sell out, I guess, maybe. I know when I was at Callaway, we played Murrah, we played the near our Provine, we would have a crowd at the door at 4:30, 4:45 for a 6 o'clock game.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the reason why we had that is because if Coach look at the players that she played with, you had a lot of Division I players, and then mm-hmm. the boys came behind that, and you had Ronnie Othello and J.J. Ryan Lothridge. So you had pros playing. If you take all the guys that played at Lanier, I played at Provine that I coached, at Callaway that I coached, you had guys that were Power Five guys playing. So it's hard to paint a picture for everybody to see, and I don't know why it's so hard, because all you got to do is, if you look back to the JPS games, you're just moving those same kids to Jackson State. Well, if you look at the crowd at a JPS game back in the day, you're moving that same crowd to a Jackson State game. The kid is a platform, and why we can't get them to see that, that's what I'm working toward, because without the player, you don't have anything. The kid is the cash cow. The kid is the platform. The kid is what makes everything go. When I'm talking to a kid, he thinks the Power Five is the platform. That's his whole thing. Coach, I got to go where I'm going to get more pub. Not knowing that if three of y'all come here, they gonna come with you. The TV gonna come with you. Zion Williamson played at Duke. I watched every one of his games when he was in college. When he graduated, I didn't watch a Duke game. I watched the game because of Zion. I called him every game because it was so exciting. Once he left, I stopped watching it. That's the same thing we're trying to tell them. TV coming if you're here. So it's just, can we sell, what do we do, or what do we have to do to sell you on that if you come here, you're going to be bigger than what you think you would be, but somebody got to do it for the first time, and that's what we battling, that person that does it for the first time.
And Coach, same thing, the culture impact, maybe even from the women's game perspective, because it seems like, maybe, not say historically, but women are a little more progressive, maybe more intentional, like mm-hmm. you were saying, like girls are like, you know, no, let's do it. Let's try mm-hmm. to figure this out.
Yeah.
So for you, what do you think the cultural impact that will have for the women?
I think, you know, players coming together to play at this level, for the culture, it would definitely bring a sense of power. It would bring a sense of dominance. It would bring a sense of togetherness. And they will understand that together we can do it. And you know, whereas when I step into the gym, when I come into the gym to play UConn, the guarantee game, they paying me $25,000 to play them. My players are hitting the floor with the mindset that we're going to beat you, because you have that mindset. Together we can. Together we're powerful. Together we're dominant. And with that mindset, you come in and you say, hey, this is a game. It doesn't matter what's on your chest. This is a game that we're coming to play, and we're coming to compete, and we're coming to dominate. And so when you bring in that caliber of athletes, that type of talent, you know, and you can create and paint that picture that, hey, we can do this. And, you know, I think that it just brings, for our culture, it just brings a type of togetherness that we need, you know, and a sense of dominance, for sure.
And when you're talking about, of course, the players make everything go, but it's not like the SWAC doesn't have coaches. I mean, Lindsey Hunter, Mo Williams is here now. Right. You've been a coach for a long time. So there are things to sell. Do you think players really look at that, or it is just, like you said, the platform? Is that what you're probably fighting against? Is that the X factor? Trying to get them to see that if you come here, you know, build it and they will come. You guys come here, this place, you know, will be rocking, selling out. And you guys already have TV.
Right.
You guys are already on TV. Right. There are ESPN packages that would just increase. Is that just the one thing you guys are just trying to drive home? It's just like, you'll be fine when you get here. Don't worry about anything else.
No, but you're talking about trying to convince somebody that's been told something for the last 30, 40, 50 years. I have alone. You're trying to change their mindset, and nobody wants to fall on the sword. Nobody wants to fall on the knife. Nobody wants to be the one to try it, because all they're seeing is Power 5, Power 5, Power 5, Power 5. That's all they see. That's all they've been told. Even from with the AAU, it's high major tennis shoe company. We play on ESPN, we play on CBS, TV games. They think that's the way to the NBA, and that mindset has to be changed. And, you know, I don't know if it'll happen during my career, but eventually it's going to happen for somebody. Eventually it's going to happen for somebody. It's going to hit, somebody's going to try. And what's going to happen is it's going to be bigger than, you know, what they ever thought. And I can take you even back to, back in the 90s, we had three kids at Callaway High School, Aaron Harper, David Sanders, and Justin Reed. And I was coaching at Callaway. We all went to Ole Miss together. Everybody said that was the wrong move. Everybody was pulling against it. They said, nah, you can't do that. That's a racist school. Y'all don't want to go there. You're not going to be able to win. They don't have no tradition. We went there. We go to the Sweet 16. We finished number 9 in the country. You're talking about three kids that's from JPS, from Provine High School. Bring those same three kids to Jackson State, and you got the same thing. Those three kids went to Kentucky and won. They went to Florida and won. They went to Alabama and won. They went to Auburn and won. They went to Mississippi State and won. They got in the NCAA tournament and won. So, you know, three kids, that's three spots out of five, and all three were ranked in the top 75 in the country. And they went somewhere where at the time, basketball was not considered the right choice to do, to go to Ole Miss. It wasn't considered, even though it was in a Power 5 conference, it was at the bottom of the league. And it was tough convincing those three guys to go. And you're talking about in the 90s, 1998, 1999, that was a hard sell to do.
And Coach Rhea, I was just thinking, when it comes to women's basketball, the fact that you guys, you know, get a lot of transfers, you guys develop players and have success, it probably will bode very well for more HBCUs, women programs, to get their top talent, because when you think about the UConns, even the Mississippi State, when you kind of look at the talent gap, mm-hmm. even the NCAA tournament, most of the time the HBCU teams, they're looked at 16, 15 seeds, so you got to go against the 1 and 2 seed almost every time.
Mm-hmm.
And some of that comes with the non-conference scheduling, but for you guys, if you can get an Amisha, you got a young lady from Wichita State, maybe get another one, then when you guys do play, like you said, those guarantee games, and it's like, oh, like women's basketball, like the talent gap isn't that far now. Like, mm-hmm. like I said, we can compete with you guys. Is that another selling point, saying like those bot scores you see of us getting blown out by 100, that would be totally different if you come mm-hmm. here?
And that's definitely the selling point for players to understand the impact that they can immediately have at this level. You know, when we look at, you know, when we're looking at recruits, for me, it's really important to get to the parents, because a lot of times these Power 5 schools come in and paint pictures that's not really important. When you talk about charter flights, charter buses, when you talk about facilities, when you talk about money, you know, yeah, that's okay, but that's not really important. Your happiness, your peace of mind, you being treated like a person and not a product. You receiving love along with discipline. You know, you really truly getting prepared for life after college, because let's face it, not everybody going to go to the next level to play. And so when you're able to create those pictures and really get a parent to understand what's really important, you know, you can lessen that gap. When you go play a UConn, you can bring in players, because those players aren't happy. If you look at the transfer portal over this last year, it has increased significantly with players leaving those Power Five schools, coming down to HBCUs or coming down to mid-major schools. Because it's a line, it's a product line. You gotta produce, perform, or you gotta get out. You know, and here is a little bit different. You know, I'm gonna work with you a little bit here. We're gonna do things a little bit different. I'm gonna get you where you need to be. When we have tough times, we're gonna get through those tough times together. But at the end of the day, it's different here than what they're doing there. The pressure is different there and here. You know, you're talking about a coach who's making $1 million of, you know, in salary, you know, versus some coaches that aren't. So you know what, you have to treat your players a little bit tough, a little bit rougher. You're not as hands-on as you should be. I'm hands-on here, because your ultimate is my goal, to help you, you know, further your education, further your career in basketball, if that's what you want to do. But it's really important to get to the parents and get them to see the real clear picture of what it's really about. And that's different for men's basketball. You know, women's basketball is from the heart. You know, it's, and a lot of players don't come because they want to necessarily go to the next level and play. They just want to have a great opportunity and a great chance. And so that's what we try to create. And I think if you can bring those players in, you can lessen those gaps and be able to go in and beat some of those teams.
But now that everyone is, quote unquote, being woke now, and you're kind of seeing things in the Power Five. Vanderbilt, they just named their first black woman AD, you know, Dawn Staley. She's had a lot of success. And I wonder if they see kids going, it's like, hey, we're gonna hire more black coaches, more black, you know, administrators at this level to kind of show more diversity. Do you think that could be a reaction if players start going, and then it's almost, not say you're back in that fight again, but, you know, trying to sell your program against, it's like, well, I still go Power Five and still quote unquote get that experience somewhat, because I'm playing for someone who looks like me and maybe the AD looks like me as well, so I feel like I'll have a shot. Do you anticipate maybe that happening, or is it like, you know, as long as you're going somewhere and, you know, we're there, you know, okay, cool, I understand, that kind of thing.
You know what, I think that's a good point, because one of the things we talked about last night when we were texting the different guys, one thing came up with, Coach, what do you think each Power Five school, they got the black assistant coach there, and the black assistant coach is shooting it down. And the black assistant coach has to survive to eat. So he's not gonna just let it happen. So that was one of the questions that actually did come up, you know, the black assistant coach. Some Power Five schools got two, and that's the person that keeps it afloat. That's the one that can relate to the kid. And that's the person who got the relationship with the kid, and that's what they sell them on, is, you know, we got so-and-so right here, and that's what makes the mom feel comfortable, that's what makes the dad feel comfortable, or whoever's making the decision. So I'm sure if you, you know, start to hire an AD and put some more pieces around it, that's something that will continue to help it. But at the end of the day, you know, That helps everybody, I guess.
And last few, anything you guys want to add about this point? Anything that you want to stress even more about, you know, this topic? And hopefully, what could be the start of a trend we can see?
I think this time is a really important time for us to be awake, woke, as they say, stay woke. I think it's really important just for the culture, but just for us as an entirety to come together, everyone. I think it's a time for us to not be so shallow, to be open to different opportunities, to be open to learning what's all around us and not just have a small mind to just what we see. You know, I would like to encourage people to look more into Jackson State, to look more into your HBCUs, you know, and I want players to understand the dynamics that they have, the power that they have, the tools that they have, and wherever they go, those things will follow. And so wherever they choose to go. And so I just want everybody to be encouraged and just, you know, look at that from that standpoint. And do your homework. Do your homework. You have to go somewhere where you're going to be treated as a human, where you're going to be treated fairly, and where you're going to have fun and be respected in everything that you do. I think those things are really important. And so I just think that's an important aspect of life right now. There's a lot of disrespect. There's a lot of, you know, things that are going on right now for our culture that needs attention to be made to. So I just think that we have to be open-minded when we're looking at where we want to go and spend our time and use this time to just gain a lot of knowledge.
Oh, I guess in closing, the one thing that comes to my mind that I would like to see, you know, the incident with George Floyd, and I keep going back to that because that's the underlying thing. That's what brought all of this about. That's what opened up the can of worms. That's what put it at the forefront. My question, when I'm talking to the guys now in the group text last night or the last couple of weeks, is what happened when the body go in the ground? You know, when that dirt is placed on that casket 5 weeks from now, does this go away? Are you still calling the HBCUs, talking about we trying to get this done? That's my biggest thing because it's a cycle and it happens over and over and over and over. And once the person, whatever incident happened, once it goes away, everything go away and then it come back to normal and we still stuck in the same situation. So my thing would be once that they have that funeral, once that body is gone, you know, over the next 4 or 5 weeks, over the next 4 or 5 months, over the next year, where are we, you know, a year from now? Are we making any ground? Do we have one Power Five kid that says it? Not maybe at Jackson State, but at a you know, at a Alcorn, at a Valley, at a, you know, wherever, just to give it a start. And hopefully it's not at a Valley or Alcorn, but hopefully it's at Jackson State.